So welcome to this lecture on Markov decision process. In fact, this is the last lecture of this training course on AI and ML. So in day three, we have discussed about the different searching process associated with the AI terminology. In fact, we have discussed about the uninformed kind of searching, where this breadth first search, depth first search, and uniform cost search was discussed. And in case of informed the searching, we have talked about the greedy best first search and the ester algorithm. Now, while considering those different search mechanisms like DFS or BFS, the only assumption that we have made is that from any particular state, suppose the starting state is given by, say, S1. So from the state, as we are moving to some other state by taking some action, suppose the new state is S2, taking a particular action, say A1. So that particular transition from state S1 to state S2, as controlled by the action A1, is deterministic in nature. That means whenever I am in state 1, I know that if I apply the action A1 over it, I'll move to a new state that is known as S2. And whenever we are in state S2, then I take another action, say A2, I can move to some other state. On the other hand, being at state S1, if I take action, say A2, I can move to some other state, some new state like S3. So when the AI agent is performing some action like A1 and A2 on being at state S1, so it is quite apparent and it is quite evident which particular state it will move. So being at state S1, if the action is A1, then the next state will be S2. If the action is A2, then the next state will be S3. So those actions were deterministic in nature. And once the AI agent takes this action, being any particular state, say S1, he knows where he wants to go, where he is going to reach. For example, being at state S2, if it takes action like, say, A1, suppose it will move to a new state called S4. And if the action taken is A3, it will move to another state like S5. So for the AI agent, if he takes action like A1 and if he is at state S1, then it knows that the next state where he is going to reach is S2. On the other hand, if the present state is S2 and if the action is same, that is A1, he knows it pretty well that where he is going to be. If S2 is the current state, and because of the action A1, the next state will be S4. And accordingly, this entire search space was investigated. So in fact, in case of the searching process, we normally deal with two different entities. One is known as the environment, and second one is known as the agent. So far in the discussion on searching mechanism, we have considered that this environment is ideal in nature. Now, what do you mean by the ideal environment? That means all the parameters of the environment will exhibit some characteristics which can be resembled to the ideal property. For example, one can consider the environment to be static in nature. That means all the parameters of the environment will not change over time. And the action which any particular agent is taking, being at any particular state, this action is also deterministic. That means the output of the action is also deterministic. So if the agent knows the present state and if the agent performs this action, the corresponding output is also deterministic. That means the corresponding state in which the agent is going to is also deterministic. Moreover, it is assumed that the agent is having the full knowledge about the entire environment, about the entire search space. For example, if I consider the 8 puzzle problem, so before the start of the searching process, the environment must know what about the different states corresponding to that particular problem under consideration. Similarly, this particular criteria is known as the fully observability of the environment. That means we can fully observe the environment. Each and every state of the environment is clearly known to the AI agent. Whenever the AI agent is observing something, some of the properties of the environment, this observation can be perfect observation, or because of some noise, it could have been also the noisy observation. And when the AI agent is taking some action, this action can be instantaneous or durative. So these are the different parameters which will create the search algorithms even more complex. So far, in our previous discussion, we have assumed that we are working with static environment. That means all the properties are remaining fixed. We have assumed that the action taken by the AI agent is deterministic in the sense that after taking the action, the corresponding outcome as produced is deterministic. There is no probability associated with that. And it is fully observable. That means the AI agent must be having the entire information about the state space. And the observation that it makes about the environment is perfect. There is no noise about it. The perfect observation. And the action it takes is instantaneous in nature. So these are the different attributes which were assigned to the previous search problems that we have dealt already. Now, we will be discussing about different types of search process where one of the parameters pertaining to this agent environment problem is modified, and let us check how to find out the search algorithm under this condition. Now, out of these different parameters that we have already discussed here, like the property of the environment, whether the action taken is deterministic or not, what about the observability of the interstate space, and whether it's perfect observation or noisy observation, and what about the action, whether it is instantaneous or durative. Now let us make a single change in this parameter set, and let us assume that so whenever the AI agent is taking some action, the corresponding outcome is not fixed. Rather, it will follow a probability, and Accordingly, we can mention that the corresponding outcome that is obtained is a stochastic. For example, if I once again go back to the 8 puzzle problem, for example, let me consider this is the start state, for example, say 1 to 5, 8 blank 3, 7, 9, 4. This is the start state. Now, if I apply the operator U, then the AI agent knows where it wants to go or where you will reach. So if the operator is U, it will be like 1, gap 5, 8, 2, 3, 7, 9, 4. So there is no probability associated with this kind of outcome. Every time you do this action, this is the starting state, for example, and every time you apply the action U over it, you'll be getting this outcome, this state. So the outcome is deterministic, what we have called so far. But you must appreciate that all of the actions which you normally deal in our real life, so all the actions may not produce the same outcome. It depends upon the probability. Suppose every day you reach the bus stop at say 9:30 in the morning and you are supposed to avail a bus, a particular route number, and the bus reaches the bus stop around say 9:35 or 9:40 and you avail the bus and you reach the destination within say 10:30. So what is the action? The action is that you avail the bus around 9:40. Now, you are in a particular state. What is the state? The state is that you reach the bus stop. You reach the bus stop at 9:30. That is the present state. The next action is that you avail the bus at 9:40 and the resultant state is you reach the destination by 10:30. But although I'm saying like this, you must appreciate that this entire thing cannot be repeated every day. Even if you reach by 9:30 at the bus stop, the bus may come at 9:50, or even if you avail the bus at 9:40, there might be traffic jam. And as a matter of fact, you might not reach the destination within 10:30. So there could have been, say, 1 hour late or 30 minutes late. That is because our environment, which I'm talking about, is not at all deterministic in nature. So even if I do the right action, the outcome, regarding the outcome, I don't know what will I get. But once I apply this operator and to the present state and I reach to a new state, then I know everything about the status of the present state. Suppose you reach the bus stop at 9:30. The bus has arrived at 9:40, for example. You avail the bus at 9:40. And while you are traveling, you have experienced that, okay, there is a lot of traffic jam due to some reason. And as a matter of fact, normally you require say, 30 minutes of time or 40 minutes of time to reach to the destination. But now you require say 1 hour and 20 minutes. So that is a probabilistic outcome, stochastic outcome. And once you have experienced this one, then ultimately you have reached at the destination at say 10:45 with 20 minutes late. Now once you are late, then you know where you are. So initially you are at a particular state. Initially you are at a state S1. You have taken the proper action, that is A. Now there could have been several states where you can reach. Either you is at S2, which is the normal one, or you can reach S3, or some other states. So depending upon the way you formulate the problem. So if I observe these different states, so accordingly each of them are having their corresponding probability. Usually you reach in time. Usually you reach by 10:30. So it's having a high probability, say 0.7 or 0.8. Occasionally you reach exactly at 10:30. Not before 10:30, exactly at 10:30. That is S3. And sometimes, very rarely, you can also reach the destination with a delay of say 15 minutes or say 20 minutes. So accordingly, even if I take the proper action, the outcome is not at all deterministic. And it happens everywhere. So then the AI people have thought to model the searching process in such a way in which the outcomes are not deterministic. Rather, the outcomes are stochastic in nature. And they have come up with a particular model, which is known as Markov decision model. Now, in this particular Markov decision process or Markov decision model, the idea is the next state is determined on the basis of the present state you are in and action that you take. So while you are in state S1, and if you take the action A1, so there is a possibility that you can move either to state S2 or to move to state S3, or you can also move to state S4. So this is basically controlled by this state only, the previous state, that is S1, and the action you take. And depending on the probability, you can reach to three different states. So while making this decision, whether you would be in S2 or S3 or S4, only the information regarding the last state, that is S1, is important. The system doesn't bother about what happened before S1. Before S1, you could have been S0 or S0 dashed or S0 double dashed. So system doesn't bother about that. And that is the property of Markov process. That means the future will be dependent upon the present only. In future, what should be my state that is essentially governed by the action which I take at this particular moment and the state which I am in right now. So the future state is not at all dependent upon the past state. Rather, it will depend upon on the present state and the present action. On the other hand, if you consider the situation about the present state, so while making the notion about the situation about the present state, so this was decided on the basis of the past state, that is S0, and the action taken. So in this way, all the information about the past states are already embedded into the present state S1. So whenever we say that the future state will depend upon the present state and the action, present action, then already all the previous information are implicitly incorporated into this particular state. So accordingly, we can define the basic parameters pertaining to this particular decision process. So one is the set of states. If I regard it like S, so this S is nothing but a set of states. Permissible states. Now, since I have considered that the environment is fully observable, that means I do have the necessary information about all the state of the states. And I must be knowing the state of actions. Which are the possible actions permissible under the present condition? So A stands for the state of actions. Now these are already well-known thing as far as our understanding in intelligence search is concerned. Now apart from that, we do have a transition model, because even if you are in state S, any particular state small s within this capital S, and even if you take an action, let me consider any set, any small set S belonging to this capital S, and any action A belonging to this A. So even if you are in state S and you take the action A, there is no guarantee that you will reach to some other state S1 or S dash. The movement of state from one to another, from S to S dash, is not guaranteed, even if you take the same action. So here, even if you are in state S1, and even if you take the action A, you can either reach to S2 or S3 or S4 with a different probability. So that's why in this particular model, we have to associate one probability function that identifies what is the probability that being at state S and taking an action A, you will reach to a state S dash. So this is known as the transition model. So this will give you the probability. This is known as the transition model. This will give you the probability that if you are in state S and if you take the action A, then what is the probability, this transition model will tell you what is the probability that you will reach at state S dashed. Last time, you understand that the corresponding probabilities were not there. The notion of probability was not there. You know that from this particular state, if I perform the action U, then I will always reach over here. So if S is this much, if S is this one, the present state, and if S just is this one, and if A is U, then the probability is one. And if A is other than U, like L, D, or R, the probability is zero. Similarly, if the action is U, and if this is the next state, and if you select any state other than this one, then obviously the probability will be zero. So if this is the present state and this is the action, then you are sure about the next state. So there was no such uncertainty associated with the outcome. And this makes the difference here. It is always having some transition model that dictates the corresponding probability. And accordingly, we do a requirement cost model that if I want to go from state S to state S dash with an action A, then what about the cost that I need to pay? So this is the cost model. And we do have a set of goals, and these goals are absorbing or non-absorbing. What is meant by absorbing goal and non-absorbing goal will be understood whenever I will give you the notion of the horizon. So the model is so generous that it can deal with the absorbing goal or non-absorbing goal. I'll mention what is meant by absorbing goal and what is meant by non-absorbing goal. And you could have a number of goals, so that's a set of goals. Sometimes some starting state is given to you. Start state. And we do introduce two other parameters. One is known as the reward parameter. Or your model, that if you move from state S to state S dash by keeping an action A, then what reward you are getting, and a discount factor. So in fact, this Markov decision process deals with those decisions which are made with uncertainty over a long time. So that is the important feature of Markov decision process. I must mention this one. This deals with the decision-making process with uncertainty. That means the corresponding outcome is not deterministically identified over a long time. That is important. And here comes the notion of this absorbing goal and non-absorbing goal. So you would perform a series of actions. So your action is not over. Like an 8 puzzle problem. So this is the starting state. You do some specific number of actions. And if you can find out the goal state, then your job is over. Under this case, the depth of this particular search space will be finite. If I consider no duplicates is maintained, then after a certain interval, we'll be sure that ultimately we have reached the goal. And once you reach the goal, you are done. And this is known as an absorbing goal. Now, there could have been some other types of goals which are known as non-absorbing goal. And in case of absorbing goal, as you understand, the number of steps that the AI agent will take will be finite. Now, apart from this, sometimes in order to find out the corresponding path, you have to move several times, or you have to search infinitely, and that is known as the infinite horizon. Or you could have indefinite horizon as well. So I'll be discussing what is meant by the finite horizon, what is meant by infinite horizon, and what is meant by the indefinite horizon. Before that, let us try to understand what is meant by this discount factor, or what is the need of introducing a discount factor over here. For example, let us consider that I can take two actions, action number one and action number two, and I have to do that action several times, ideally infinite number of times, I have to do that action. Now the reward, what I am going to get after performing the action one, suppose the reward is one. And if I do the action number two, the reward is two. So I can perform two action. If I perform action one, the reward will be one. And if I perform action two, the reward will be two. So if we just understand, or if we can remember the concept of uniform cost search or so, then you must feel that if I am getting a more reward, that means if I need to pay less cost, so that particular action is beneficial to me. So I do have two different options. I can perform two actions, either one or two. By performing action one, I'll be getting a reward of one. By performing another action, action number two, I'll be getting a reward of two. Because in practice, whenever you are in any particular state and you move to some other state, the corresponding cost that we are paying is not the same. So it will be logical to associate some cost or reward associated with the particular movement from one state to another. So for example, we have two states to go from the present state, that is one and two, and the corresponding reward that I'm getting is one and two respectively. So if it is a finite horizon problem, in which case from the starting state, I can move, say, up to n number of states. So if I follow this action one, and if all the successive actions pertaining to action one will give me a reward of one, then altogether, the total reward that I should collect is n. And on the other hand, if I follow action two, and if it is told that all the successive actions of action two will also give me a reward of two, then under this condition, the total reward that you will be getting is two times of n. So which one is much more lucrative? In one case, you will be getting a reward of n. In other case, you will be getting a reward of 2n. So obviously, the second action will be much more lucrative to you because it gives you more reward. But the point is that here we are not talking about the finite horizon problem, rather infinite horizon problem. That means the movement of state from one to another through the AI agent. So the number of times the AI agent moves from one state to another state, this is not finite. For example, if you are asked to roam around circular ground, around the perimeter of a circular ground again and again, so it will be infinite horizon problem. You start from a particular point, you travel through the perimeter, you come to that particular point once again, and you go on in this way. It's an infinite horizon problem. Now if it is told that if you travel in clockwise direction, the corresponding reward is one, and if you do it in anti-clockwise fashion, the reward is two. And since the number of steps that you are making to complete the process is infinite, then obviously 1 into infinity and 2 into infinity cannot be segregated. So that's why for this infinite horizon problem, this discount factor is useful. How is it useful? So this will be useful for infinite horizon problem. And in Markov decision process, we will be dealing with both the infinite as well as finite and indefinite horizon problem. The idea is to make the total reward or total cost finite. Total reward or total cost finite. That is the idea. Now, if the reward is say R or R1, now if I consider a situation like this with no discounting, and if I'm going to make it a general, like say gamma 1 is not there, so let me start with no discounting. Suppose the first reward, let it be R1, second reward, let it be R2, third reward, let it be R3, and so on. And if this is done infinite times, remember that R1, R2, R3, they are positive and might be integer as well. If I sum it like R1 plus R2 plus R3 up to infinity times, it will give you a value of infinity. Irrespective of the individual value of R1, R2, and R3. Even if I make it like 1, 1, 1, it will also be called infinity. And if I make it like 2, 2, 2, it will also become infinite. So to make total reward finite, even for this infinite origin problem, the AI researchers have borrowed the idea from the economics. The intuition was, the money today is worth more than the money tomorrow. If I have 100 rupees today, and if I have 100 rupees after 1 year, I am having the same amount of money, 100 rupees. But 100 rupees today is more worthy than the 100 rupees after 1 year. So accordingly, some discount factor is associated, because if I have 100 rupees today, that is equivalent to 104 rupees after 1 year. Because if I keep this 100 rupees in bank, at least I'll be getting an additional 4 rupees as an interest. At least 4 rupees. If you invest somewhere else, you can earn more. So if not, if you are given this 100 rupees one year, after 1 year, then instead of having 104, you are getting only 100. Say 98% or 97% of 104 equal to 100. So then the discount factor becomes 97. Because instead of getting 104, you are now getting 100. So this idea from economics were taken into consideration during the calculation of total reward. And with discounting, the total reward is given by R1, that is fine, which is the reward that I'm getting being at step one, and then the gamma times of R2, which is done at step number 2, and then gamma square times R3, and so on. Similarly, if I would like to find out the total cost, remember that cost is just reverse as compared to the reward. Our objective here is to maximize the reward or minimize the cost. So similarly, the cost can be written like C1 plus gamma times C2 plus gamma square times C3, and so on. So now if you just consider two different scenarios, suppose two different actions I am considering. Action 1 and action 2. So for action 1, the reward is 1. For action 2, the reward is 2. Now if I go on doing the same operation infinite number of times, because Markov decision process deals with the decision making process with uncertainty over a long time. If I repeat the process So what reward I am getting? 1 plus gamma 1 plus gamma square 1 plus gamma q 1, so on. So this is nothing but 1 plus gamma square plus gamma q up to infinity. And as long as the value of gamma is less than 1, it gives rise to 1 upon 1 minus gamma. And on the other hand, here you will be getting 2 by 1 minus gamma. So here the total reward over a long time up to infinity will be 1 by 1 minus gamma, and here it will be 2 by 1 minus gamma. So now these two are different. In one case you are finding like 1 by 1 minus gamma, in other case 2 by 1 minus gamma. Assuming gamma is less than 1, finite, I mean if 0 less than gamma less than 1, if this condition is satisfied, then obviously these two numbers are bounded and this one is much worthy than this one. So to make sense that at this particular moment I am doing the same action, say A1 or A2, and correspondingly two different rewards are given to me, 1 and 2. So if I do it infinite number of times, it seems that these two actions didn't have any significant difference. To make sense, the notion of this discount factor has been incorporated, and by introducing this notion, we can understand that the action number 2 is much more worthy than the action number 1. Then now let us try to understand what about the objective of any Markov decision process. Since it's a kind of decision making process, so what should be the objective? So the objective of this MDP is to find a policy. It is not that, unlike your traditional searching problem like breadth first search or depth first search, the idea is not to provide a path, because you don't know which path you will find it out, because it depends upon the probability. So before the action, you do not know what is going to happen. Suppose you are in particular state S1. You have planned to take an action A. Now, under deterministic world, the obvious state at which you will reach is S2. But since we are dealing with undeterministic state or undeterministic condition, when the stochastic outcomes will be the result, so you never know, even after taking the action A and being at the state S1, where you will reach. You may reach with S2 with a probability, say, P1. Or rather P2, you may reach the state S3 with a probability say P3, you may reach at S4 with a probability say P4, and so on. You have to consider all the possible states where you can reach being at state S1. For example, when some student enters in any institution, then there could have been three possibilities. For any particular course, when he attends any degree course or postgraduate degree course, or any diploma course, for example, there could have been three different possibilities. Either he clears all the paper and passes that particular course, qualifies, or disqualified, perhaps failed in some of the papers, so disqualified, or he might have left the institution because of non-compliance. So at the very beginning, whenever if S1 is considered to be the admission to any institution, to any particular course, and if A is thought to be the set of action which a student is supposed to do during his course of study, like attending lectures, attending the laboratories, submitting the assignments, submitting the projects, appearing for the examination, written examination, appearing for the oral examination, presenting the progress. if all of them are considered to be the set of actions which are to be performed, then the final state, whether the student will be under state S2 or S3 or S4, is completely unknown. A probability is assigned with each of them. For example, the probability S2 might be very large, like 0.9 or 0.95. S3 could be small, like 0.04. And there is a very small probability, however small it may be, like 0.01, that the student might leave the institution because of non-compliance. So here, the path is not important. As we have talked about during our discussion in intelligent search, a search mechanism, like your breadth first search or depth first search, the path is not important. Rather, here the objective is to find a policy. Find a policy or a function. This policy is regarded as a function pi that will map the set of states to a set of action. This is the objective. You need to find a policy so that from a given set of state, you can find out the corresponding set of actions with certain conditions. So what are the conditions? The condition is that this policy must be able to maximizes the expected reward to reach the goal. I should not use the term rather to reach a goal, because there could have been non-absorbing goal as well. Or this is also equivalent to minimizes the expected cost to reach a goal. So this should be the objective. And it is assumed that the AI agent must be well aware about all the states of the particular environment. That means full observability property is ensured here. Now, while doing this action, maximizing the expected reward, now the term expected has been added, because each of the action from one state to the another state is guided by some probability. Now, since it is guided by some probability, so we should introduce the term expectation so that the corresponding reward or cost is not the actual one, rather the expected one, given by some probability under certain horizon. Now, what do you mean by horizon? That means the number of steps given a finite horizon. So that depends upon the problem under consideration, or infinite horizon, or indefinite horizon. So what is meant by finite horizon? That means from the starting state to the goal state, the number of steps that the AI agent has taken is finite in nature. So within the paradigm of this finite horizon, the objective is to maximize the goal. Maximize the reward to reach the goal. For example, if I consider this particular example, that you are in state number S1, and there could have been, suppose the goal is to reach to state S2, that is the goal. So you have to pass all the papers so that you are declared as qualified. So now the horizon is finite, because you should have 4 years of time for study, or 3 years of time for study, or 2 years of time for study, depending upon the course. And within the stipulated time, you have to complete your course. And accordingly, you need to maximize the total CGPA. The goal is to qualify, that is S2, with an objective to maximize the expected reward. That means with the objective is to maximize the CGPA, or minimizing the cost. Sometimes the cost may be regarded as the number of papers in which you have failed previously. You must try to minimize the number of papers in which you have failed. Ideally, you should not want to get failed in any of the papers. So that is the cost part. So you'd like to minimizing the cost and maximizing the reward. Now, when the movement from this present state S1 to the next state S2, and there could have been some intermediate state as well. So I'm talking about the first state, the starting state S1 and the end state or goal state S2. Obviously, you must understand that there are set of intermediate states in between. So if you are a undergraduate student, then initially when you have entered the institution, then you are in state 1 or S0 or state S1. Then you have admitted in the first year of study. Then you complete your course there, and then you move to the, and if you have qualified all the papers, then you can move to the second year. That means from SF to SS, first to second, then second to third, SS to ST, and then third to fourth, ST to SF. And ultimately, if you can move through all these states successfully, there could have been a final evaluation, and based on that, you'll be declared as qualified. So the number of, if I consider the number of years or number of days available to you to reach from state S1 to S2, that is fixed. That is finite. So while taking an action, being in a particular state, you cannot do it over 10 years or 20 years or 50 years. This is not possible. So it is limited. So it is meant by the finite horizon problem. Sometimes the objective could have been different. Your objective is to maximize the reward, expected reward, or minimize the expected cost to reach the goal. And you have been provided with infinite horizon, ideally. Perhaps in the newspaper, you will find some of the events which is really inspiring for us. You'll find that some person has qualified class 10 or class 12 at an age of 40, at an age of 50, at an age of 60, or even at an age of 70, or even large. These are really inspiring news to us. So there the objective is to qualify that particular examination. That is the only objective. And the horizon is infinite, ideally infinite. If death is not the constraint, if death is not the barrier, then you may think that, so that particular fellow will keep on trying again and again, unless he succeeds. So here the problem is the maximization of the goal of the reward, or we can say that the objective is to reach that particular state with infinite horizon. So there is no time limit, there is no time bound. And sometimes the third problem, the third horizon that I'm talking about, is all about the absorbing goal. Think as an absorbing goal. Suppose you are in particular state S1. After taking some action A, you have reached at some state S2. So you have started with S1. After taking some set of actions, you have reached to a state SG1. Now, what is SG1? SG1 stands for, or SG1, I can say that SG1 belongs to the goal set. But this is not the only goal what I am talking about. There are plenty of such goals in your problem formulation. So once you are done, so your job is not over. The system will say that, okay, you have done it. That's fine. Now you go on for the next goal. So from SG1, you will go for another. That is SG2, the second goal. And from second goal to say third goal and so on. And this will be continued. Unless all the goals are attained. So this type of problem is known as the absorbing goal problem. And the horizon in which this kind of operation is being performed is known as the indefinite horizon. So there is a difference between infinite and indefinite. In case of infinite, you have not reached the goal. You are searching for the goal, but you have taken infinite amount of time to reach the goal. Or at least infinite amount of time has been provided to you to reach the goal. And in case of indefinite horizon, the number of times provided to you is finite, but once you reach the goal by taking some finite number of steps, that is not the end of the story. You have to search for another such goal. So these are the some notions with which we will try to figure out the different models of MDP or Markov decision process. Now to start with, let us consider a parent state or parent node. So this is the starting node, that is P. Now from this state, one can take two different action. One is A, and the second action is B. Now while taking the action A, there could have been two different outcomes. One is the state Q, and second one is the state R with a different probability. Let it be say 0.6, let this be 0.4. And while you have taken action B, there also you can reach to two other states. Let it be S and T with the corresponding probability of 0.5 and 0.5, for example. Now, suppose this is the goal state identified by G. And you can reach to the goal state from each of these states, Q, R, S, and T. I can redraw that part. So this is the goal state. The action might be C. And now let us try to identify the corresponding cost. Say the cost of taking the action A is equal to 5. And the cost of taking the action B is equal to 10. And the cost of taking the action C is equal to, say, 1. Now, under this condition, now if you are at state number P, then what should be the proper action to select? Now I can consider this particular state, this particular action A, through which I can attain like P to Q, Q to G, or P to R, and then G if I take the action A. And on the other hand, if I take this action B, then it could have been B to P to S, and then G, and P to T, then G. Then you have to identify whatever the value of these different nodes. Value means whatever the distance between these states, I mean these states and the corresponding goal state. Since the action that one can take to reach from state Q to state G is C, that means being at state Q or R or S or T, if one can take an action C, then you can reach at state number G, which is the goal state. So the value for the state Q or R or S or T being the same, that is 1. Then what about the value of P? So value of P can be written like if I follow this path. So here the values are the same, because being at Q or R or S or T, the only action that you need to do is C, and you can reach it directly. So that is why it is 1. Now, in order to find out the value, you have to find out the corresponding cost, and the minimum of this cost will give you the value. Now you can take this route P comma A. What is the value? So here it's nothing but initially you have started with C of A, that is 5. And then 0.6 into the value of Q, that is 1, plus 0.4 into value of R, that is also 1. So ultimately, this will give you a cost of 6. Similarly, if you follow the other path, here you'll see that initially this cost equal to 10, and then 0.5 into 1 plus 0.5 into 1. So ultimately, you have ended up with 11. So if you can follow this path to reach to the goal, then the corresponding cost becoming 6. And if you take this path to reach to the goal, the corresponding cost equal to 11. So the value identifies the minimum of this cost. So the value of P is nothing but 6 here. So accordingly, you decide that action A has to be taken. To reach the goal G from the starting node P. Now, this notion cannot be useful whenever you do have a cyclic Markov decision process. In fact, this particular diagram, which we have shown over here, is known as acyclic Markov decision process. Now, let us observe a cyclic Markov decision process And let us try to mark out which particular path should I select. So in case of cyclic Markov decision process, it will be something like that. So there is a possibility that you may return back to the original state. Suppose if I take the action A, I can reach to P again, or I can reach to some other state like R. And on the other hand, if I take the action B over here, then there is no provision to go back to the previous state, that is A, that is P. And either you can go to state S or to state T. And the goal state is located over here, and you can reach it directly like this. So the action taken over here is C. And let me point out the probability. Suppose this is 0.6. Now here it is 0.4. The total probability should be 1. So 0.5, 0.5. So since being at state R or S or T, the corresponding value is equal to 1, so I'm considering the previous cost model. That means C of A is equal to 5, C of B is equal to 10, and C of C is equal to 1. So what about V of R? What is value of R? That is equal to value of S. That is equal to value of T, because they have only one path to go to the G. So this is equal to the C of R. I mean C of C. What about Q of P comma B? We have already calculated this one last time. 10 here, 0.5 into 1 plus 0.5 into 1. That means 11. But what about Q of P comma A? So take a look at this action. From the state P, if you take an action A, then with 0.6 probability, you can come to state number P, or with 0.4 probability, you can go to state number R. So as a matter of fact, if I calculate the cost is obviously higher than 6. Last time I have seen that there are two different paths. If I follow this path, I will reach to state R. If I follow this path, I will reach to state S. And both R and S lead to G using the action C. So as a matter of fact, we have a cost of 5 here and another cost of 1 here. So total cost was 6. But this time there is a 60% probability that you return back to the original state P once again. So it will increase the cost to some extent. Now let us check whether that value exceeds 11 or not. So if I write an equation, Q of P comma A, this is given by, first of all, you do have a cost of 5. Because C of A equal to 5. And then there is a 40% chance, 0.4 probability to reach at state R. So accordingly, it will be like 0.4 times 1. And there will be 60% probability to reach to the state P once again. Then what is the cost that I need to pay if I reach once again at state number P? It will be the same QPA. So what we find is, if I take in that direction, so it will be like 0.4 times QPA is equal to 5.4. So from that, if you calculate 5.4, so it will be like 5.4 by 0.4. That means 5.4 into 10 by 4. So 54 by 4, that means 27 by 2, that is 13.5. So now the cost is 13.5. So under this condition, where the cyclic MDP is there, so one should prefer to select the path B or select the action B so that the expected cost is minimum. What was our objective? Our objective is to minimize the expected cost. So here, last time for acyclic MDP, the expected cost for the action A was 6 and for the action B was 11. And this time, the expected cost for the action A is 13.5 because there was a recursive loop, and for the action B, it is 11. So here, we should prefer the action B. This is the action to be taken, and we should write that value of P is not 6, rather it is 11, because this is the minimum cost that you need to pay to reach from P to G. And this is an example of cyclic MDP. So how we can understand which path to select, rather at any particular, being any particular state, which action to select? So one can go for a brute force kind of algorithm where all the policies will be evaluated. So we have mentioned that pi being the policy. So check for all the policies pi. And we need to evaluate all the policies and choose the policy so that this gives us the minimum cost, minimum expected cost. So the objective here is to go over all the policies or consider all the policies on the policies pi you need to evaluate each of the policy and then find out the policy say pi star, for example, for which the expected cost of reaching the goal is minimum. So if I consider that the evaluation of this policy can be done with the aid of a function, which is nothing but v pi of s, which gives me the expected cost of reaching the goal from the set S so we will be looking for a policy pi star for which v pi star S is less than or equal to v pi S. Now before answering this question, we need to find out how many policies are there. The policy is regarded as a mapping from the state to the action. So there are, for example, we have initially considered that this S stands for a set of states and A stands for the set of actions. And the policy is a mapping from the state to the action. So whenever you are in a particular state, you can take a number of different actions. Then how many such states are there? The cardinality of S. So therefore, the number of policies which can be there is the cardinality sign, the number of elements within the set S, a to the power mod S. That means the number of states present within this particular process. So this number of policies will exist. So all these policies are known to you because we are talking about a full observable system. That means the system must be knowing about all the possible states, all the possible action, and therefore all the possible policies. So for a particular policy pi, we need to find out this, we have to compute the corresponding V pi, which is nothing but the cost of reaching the goal following pi. So you are at state number S. So what do you mean by V pi S? This is the expected cost of reaching the goal from the state S, and when you follow the policy pi. Because if you are at state S, then based upon pi, you can select the corresponding action. Because the policy pi is a mapping from S to A. So you are at a particular state S. Let it be say small s. You are in a particular state S, and that S must belong to this capital S. Now, given this particular state, and if I follow this particular policy pi, you can select the corresponding action. Suppose the action equal to say A, where A belongs to this capital A, and you reach to some other state, say S1. Then being at S1, you can take another action, say B, you reach to state S2. And then being at S2, you take another action and reach to the state S3 like this. And ultimately, you will reach to the goal. So if I follow this policy, what is the expected cost that I'm getting? For example, here, for this acyclic MDP, if I choose this particular action, so state was known to me, state was P, that is the starting state. Now there could have been two defined actions, A and B, permissible for the state P. So if I select this particular action A, then the expected cost was 6. And if I select the action B, the expected cost was 11. So I have to select the action A because it gives me the minimum expected cost. Similarly, for the cyclic MDP, the only change that we have made is the recursiveness. That instead of moving to another set R, from the state P, if you take the action A, there is a 60% chance that it will once again come back to the original state, that is P. With a probability 0.6, it will be recursive. And with a probability 0.4, it will come out of the loop. And because of this recursiveness, we have seen that if I take this policy, if I take this action, the resultant cost is 13.5. And if I take this action, the resultant cost is as before, that is 11. So now, as a general means, we would like to find out the corresponding policy. We have to evaluate each of the policy because we know how many policies are there, A to the power S. Mod S rather, the total numbers, if S is equal to 10 and A is equal to 10, then 10 to the power 10 number of such policies are there. We have to check each of these policy. We have to evaluate each of them and ultimately find out the best policy. So how can we perform the policy evaluation? So this policy evaluation is all about given a policy. So I have to check for all those policies which are existing in particular MDP. Given a policy pi, your job is to compute the V pi. What do you mean by V pi? V pi is nothing but so. V pi tells me the cost of reaching the goal using the policy pi. Suppose let us consider an acyclic MDP first. So you started with S0. Then we could have two different possibilities from the state S0. If I do particular action, I can reach to either S1 or S2. And suppose the costs are different. So suppose here I can go with a probability of 0.6, and here I can go with a probability of 0.4, and the corresponding cost equal to say 5 here, and cost equal to 2 here. And from this, each of these states S1 and S2, I can reach to the goal state, that is S of G. And the corresponding cost is equal to 1 here, and cost equal to 4 here. So for this type of acyclic MDP, one can easily find out what is the value of V pi of S1. So being at S1, what cost should I pay to reach to the goal? I have the only one option. We are here at S1. If I pay a cost of 1, I can reach to the goal state, that is SG. So the cost that I should pay at S1 if I follow this policy is equal to 1. What about S2? This is 4. So V pi S1 is equal to 1. And V pi S2 is equal to 4. Whatever V pi is. So this is the policy. Policy has been identified by this particular S versus S to A mapping. Whatever V pi is, another S0 here, because S0 is the starting state. So here, I can have two different alternative paths. One path is through this S1 to reach to SG, and the second path is through S2 to reach SG. So here, with the probability of 0.6, the cost that I should pay is 5 here plus 1 here plus, with a probability of 0.4, cost of 2 here and cost of 4 here. So 2 plus 4. So this is 6 into 0.6, that is 0.36. 6 into 0.3.6, it will be 3.6 here. And here it will be 6 into 0.4, that is 2.4. So ultimately, it will be 5, 6. So V pi S0 will be 6. So I can find out what is the value of V pi S0. So if S0 is my starting state, and if I follow this policy, so I can find out what is the value of V pi S0, that is 6. I can have a different other policy. And accordingly, one can easily find out, so suppose this is for pi 1. So similarly, you can consider for the other policies. You should have altogether a to the power s number of policies. So for pi 1, the value is 6. For pi 2, the value is might be 7. For pi 3, the value might be 4. So accordingly, I have to search for all those policies. And we need to select that particular policy, which gives us the minimum cost value. So this is for an acyclic MDP. Now, let us consider the same thing for a cyclic MDP. Now, as you understand, for a cyclic MDP, there could have been some recursiveness, and that's why the name is cyclic. So if this is the starting state, so you can go to S1. And from S1 directly, I can go to SG. And if I follow the alternative path, I may reach to S2. And then I may not directly reach to SG, rather there is a probability you can reach to SG with a probability say 0.7 and with a probability of 0.3 you can return back to S0. So that probability is 0.3. Here also I can use the same value like 0.6 and 0.4. Let me figure out the cost. Cost say 5 and 2. Here the cost is say 1. Here the cost is say 4. And here the cost is 3, for example. So what will be V pi of S1? So being at S1, if I use this policy, the cost is 1 to reach the goal. But what about V pi S2 and V pi S0? You look here. If the present state is S2, and if I take an action over here, if the action is say A2 or so, then there could have been, the outcome could have been anything. Either you reach to the goal with a probability of 0.7, or you may reach to the original previous state, S0, with a probability of 0.3. So the V pi S2 depends upon V pi S0. And obviously, since S2 is obtained from S0, so V pi S0 also depends upon V pi S2. So we can say that V pi S2, it depends upon V pi S0, and V pi S0 obviously will depend on V pi S2. So how can I write down the equation? It will be a simple linear equation. So V pi S2, so there is a 0.7 probability that you reach to the goal with a cost of 4, and 0.3 probability that you once again go back to the state S0. So what will be the cost here? So here the cost is 3. And then being at S0, the additional cost that you need to pay is V pi S0. So V pi S2 depends on V pi S0. And if I calculate for V pi S0, that can be written like, here you have 0.6 probability, so 0.6 multiplied with 5, plus you have 0.4 probability, 0.4. Now that cost is 2. And after you pay this cost, you reach at S2, and the corresponding cost incurred is V pi S2. So you have two equations with two unknown. You can easily find it out, the value for V pi S2 and V pi S0. So the ultimately, what we have is V pi S that is equal to 0 if S is a goal, if S belongs to this G. Otherwise, you could model this V pi S as a function. Now that function can be written like, let me write down the function first and then I'll try to explain. Suppose you are at state number S and you are following a policy of pi. So as you know, policy pi will map the state to an action. And accordingly, you can reach to a new state, say S dash. So as far as our model is concerned, what is the cost that you are going to pay? The cost that you are going to pay is, as per the model, you are at state number S, and we would like to find out what is the cost, the way with which we have calculated in these two equations. So you are at any particular state S0. Then if you follow this particular policy, so from S0, there could have been two different possibilities. Either you go to S1 or you go to S2 with a different probability. So already this has been written over here for this type of policy, for this particular cyclic MDP. But if I would like to make it much more general, then this is basically the sum of the different cost. So that's why at the very beginning, I have put the summation sign over here. What I'm looking for, a next state. If I am at the present state S, and if I follow the policy pi, then the action which will be taken is given by pi of S. Because pi is the function, pi is the policy that maps S from A, S to A. That mapping is done by the policy pi. So as far as model is concerned, if I go back, our model says that C, S, A, S dash is the cost model. So you are at state number S. The action that you take is pi of S. So here the action is pi of S. And you might reach to a state called S dash. So the cost that you are paying is C of S, pi S, S dash. But you never know whether S dash is the final goal or not. So that's why from S0, you have taken this part. Okay, fine. So 0.6 into 5. I think I have missed one part here. So let me correct this one. So it should be from S0 with a 0.6 probability, I will reach to state S1, and being at S1, the corresponding cost that I need to pay here is 1. So it will be 5 plus 1. It's not 5 only, because this is not the end state. It will be 5 plus 1. So you have 5 plus 1. And plus the rest part, what I have written, 0.4. Here, the cost is 2 plus V pi S2. So the corresponding cost is given by S, pi S, S dashed. If I follow the policy pi or pi S, but this is not the end, it's just not the final state, just like this. You can reach to S1, but S1 is not the final state. You need to find out what is the cost that you need to pay being at S1, following the same policy. So you have to add V pi S1 with it, S dash rather in this case, as S dash is my next state. Now, what is the probability that you may reach to state S dash from the state S by following the policy pi? The probability model we have already considered, given by this T, S comma pi S comma S dash. That was the probability. So 0.6. So this corresponds to 0.6 first. This corresponds to 5, this cost, and plus the additional V pi S1, not S dashed. And this has to be computed for all S dashed belonging to S. Now, for all S dashed belonging to S, you need to find out the corresponding cost, as we have done here. So here are only two possibilities. From this state S0, you can go either to state S1 with a probability 0.6 or with a state S2 with a probability 0.4. So with S is equal to S0, this corresponding policy will move you to different distinct states, S1 and S2. So that's why only one addition is there between the two numbers. And if you have more number of such elements, like 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, and total is 1, then accordingly, you can move to say state S1, S2, S3, S4, and so on. So in general, I can make this statement. So this is all about the evaluating the policy in a Markov decision process. So in this particular lecture, I have tried to focus briefly about the notion of Markov decision process. You have perhaps understood that the idea of Markov decision process is a bit different as compared to what you have done for the previous searching process, in which case the notion of probability was not there. The state transition from the one state to the another state was deterministic in nature. So if you know the present state and if you know the action, then the current state is guaranteed. But this time, whenever we call the Markov decision process to model the environment around us, so the movement from the one state to the another, transition from the one state to the another, is always guided by the probability. And accordingly, we have considered how to model this type of decision process, what are the different parameters by means of which we can basically evaluate the performance, what is meant by policy, what are the objectives of MDP, and how to find out the expected cost. And it has also been shown that the expected cost calculation depends upon the corresponding policy, whether the policy is a cyclic one or acyclic one. So for cyclic one, we have seen that the entire calculation is a bit different. And if the policy is acyclic, in that case, the action A seems to be more promising. However, if some cyclic component is added, that means if the policy has been changed by some means, then the previous policy or the previous action might not be lucrative. So as a matter of fact, the policy evaluation is also very important, and accordingly we have made a general discussion regarding how to find out the best policy and how to compute the cost for any policy. And we also discussed some of the examples. Now with this I would like to conclude this lecture.